this series. You'll see, and we're planning our sermon series for the fall and into the winter. And you'll notice that we'll do some topical, like some around, and we're planning one coming up on the vineyard, all the vineyard references in Scripture. But we will often do and take a book and just go through the book from the beginning to the end, and that's what we've done with Nehemiah. It's really good, because then you can kind of get a chance to maybe learn a little bit more about a text of Scripture you might not necessarily just turn to in your personal devotions, but there is a lot for us personally in a book like Nehemiah. Amen? I mean, we've been learning a lot, not only as a church, but also as individuals. This is our last message of the series. Pastor Dave preached last week, and this week he's down in Vineland as we're helping out that church, and Pastor Claude there is recovering. So Pastor Dave's down there ministering today. But he ministered last week on thankfulness. We started this whole thing out. Remember the temple of God, and the people had ignored God and walked away from God and neglected their spiritual lives, neglected caring for and nurturing their relationship with God. And as we know, in any relationship, if you neglect a relationship, then that relationship will begin to decay. If you neglect a building, the building decays. If you neglect a car, if you neglect your lawn, if you pass by and set aside something in your life, it begins to decay. Well, their spiritual lives decayed to the point of almost ruins. It was evident in the fact that the city itself was in a desperate place. The people were desperate. The walls were in ruins, and so was their spiritual lives. When Nehemiah got this word in Nehemiah chapter 1, it hit him. We have then Nehemiah 2. He's already made provisions. Interesting enough, provisions came from outside sources, secular sources, not the people of God at this point. And he started to kick into gear project restoration. Through this whole series, we've been doing a bunch of restoration. We've got some shiplap in the foyer this week, and Pastor Shelley's been given leadership not only to VBS in the summer and children's ministry, but she's been kind of like the project manager for redoing the foyer and just helping some areas of the church that needed some restoration. This is nothing, though, compared to the restoration that was needed in the city of God in Jerusalem by the hand of Nehemiah's leadership. He started off with people in Nehemiah 3 working on the windows. The areas, and you look out, you want to know where you start. You want to start restoring your marriage, your home. You want to start restoring your neighborhood. Look out your window and start right there. He has them working on the areas of the wall that's in front of the places where they live. Brilliant plan for implementing change. Night vision goggles, as soon as they started to make a little bit of change, people didn't think they'd be able to do anything. But once they started to actually make some progress, the enemy got a little bit threatened. And so the enemy tried all kinds of ways to attack and from outside and try to discourage. And then we see the next enemy is the enemy from within. It was against family member against family member, child of God against child of God. And we all know how quickly a sports team or how quickly a marriage or a relationship or a union, a business can go down when people inside start infighting. And of course, binoculars. The enemy wasn't being successful. People of God had pursued and persevered past the discouragement of the enemy, persevered past their own infighting and got past that. And so the enemy now was trying to distract. The enemy can discourage. The enemy can also has a great weapon of distraction. He starts throwing and said, "Why don't you come down and meet me? Let's have a meeting." And not all meetings are from God. Somebody probably say amen to that one. But let's have a meeting. Let's just meet together. And Nehemiah's like, "You know what? I'm doing something pretty important here. And sorry, can't make the meeting." His eyes on what God's called him to do and the task at hand. We have then a microscope. We give some kind of neat things, some details that God has ordained order. Things start getting better to the point where we need to put in some structures now. We're growing as a people of God. And the magnifying glass. Remember the time when they're looking at God's word and they realize who they were, but were all encouraged with the thought that the joy of the Lord is our strength. However, they still went back to look into that mirror and saw honestly who God is. They started reading his word. They realize some areas in their life, as they just read God's word, nobody pointing a finger, nobody giving them guilt trips, just read God's word and realize there are parts and some areas in our lives that we're maybe not walking and living the way we know we should. We got off track. Then, of course, after that, it's not important to just also know what you've done wrong, but you see the key of faithfulness and fruitfulness go hand in hand. So they put on some blinders to protect themselves from going the wrong direction. We had some structure. I remember that Sunday we had some, remember that in the middle of the mess, we kind of said, anybody else wants to get baptized? We had two people in the tank out front. Anybody else wants to get baptized? And we had some reports, and Ginger, my daughter, got baptized that day. I think we had two already and another six, I think, or something like that, made the decision to follow in obedience in Christ. The lookout was last Sunday. That's just turning our obstacles, our difficulties, our challenges, the mountains that come into your life that you think are overwhelming you, climb on top of them and make them observation points, and turn your problems into praise and thanksgiving. And now today, light, drawing us back to the way that's right, even if we've gone down the wrong path. The word says in Psalm 119, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light to my path." It's kind of an interesting closeout chapter. I mean, the story of the whole thing was all about how they had gotten away from God, and you would think that it would end with last week, Nehemiah 12, saying, you know, thankfulness to God, look what he's done. We're people of God again. People are living here. We've grown. God's blessed us. And so we're thankful what God's done. You think it'd end there. But how many know that when we go through, we have those celebration meals, those mountain experiences, those exciting times we've had a success, that real life doesn't end there? Yeah? You hit Monday or Tuesday and you have another disappointment. Another moment of, wow, that wasn't probably our best moment in our life. You have another valley. And the people of God, they were that way all the time, not just in the desert, but it's interesting here, because in Nehemiah 13, we'll see that after all that work in restoring back not only the wall, but restoring them back spiritually, Nehemiah leaves for just a little while and things go to pot. Things go downhill. Like when Moses went up on the mountain, remember, to hear from God and have direction from God for the people. When he came back, they were way off track. Most of our lives involve the need to make choices. Obviously, there's times when things affect our lives and impact us that we didn't make any choice to get us there, really. I mean, other than driving down the road and we stopped at a red light and the guy behind us slaps into our back bumper. Wham! Wow. I wasn't in reverse. I just was stopped at a red light doing what I thought. I didn't affect that. It's not like I deserved that. I shouldn't have stopped at the red light. Sometimes a disease impacts your body. You go for a regular checkup and you find yourself getting another test and another test, and then you find you've got, and it's not because of a habit. It's not because of bad eating. It's just, got sick. But we know that even though those things happen in life, and there are those moments that things affect us and we really didn't invite them on ourselves, the truth of the matter is we would agree that our life and the way we live life and where we're at and where we're going has a great deal to do with the choices we make yesterday and today. Now, I'm not trying to lock you in and be all fatalistic. We all know there are consequences to choices, yeah. And now I want you to think, good and bad. I mean, there are consequences. When we always hear consequences, we always think, there's consequences for you. But there also are good consequences. You make good decisions. I am so glad that back in 1996, I made the decision to resign the church I was pastoring in, follow the calling and the burden that God put in my heart to go to Africa, because while I was there, I was able to learn a little bit about Africa, and then when I got back, meet Pam, who was a missionary's kid from Africa. I stayed one night at her parents' place there while Pam was at York University back here. The decision to go to Africa, I've thought a couple times, what if I didn't do that? What if I stayed where I was? I might have a chance to minister and help missionaries and all that stuff, stay for 3 months, but I absolutely believe that God in his providence was calling me there not only to minister and help missionaries, but to eventually meet my wife. I told people I went to Africa to meet my wife. Speaking of Africa, I had just got a note. Deb from her mother passed away in Nigeria, and I know, and we want to pray for her. We've already prayed for a number of people that are having family members that are grieving, and I know distance can be a challenge. Pam grew up in Africa back in the day when you didn't have Facebook to find out what everybody's doing, or WhatsApp or WeChat to be able to get pictures and see how they're growing and stay updated. It was a time when you left family, you left for a long time. And you would come back maybe every 4 years and touch base and connect. And I know some of you are you have come to this country. You have loved ones all around the world, and it's tough. You hear the news down in Haiti. You've got family members in Haiti, and a loved one passes away, and it's tough to be there in those difficult times. I remember just a few days ago I was sharing at church at the camp meeting up in Silver Birches in Northern Ontario. And there was an individual there, and they got word while we're in service that a loved one had a heart attack while driving, and it went off the road and into some rocks in Northern Ontario. And this, the loved one, you know, is in the service and got the word, surrounded by the people of God. And so we prayed for them and that morning and just supported them. You know, the challenge, I mean, that's just they were just separated by a few kilometers, but some of these challenges and difficulties can be very, very hard. People that make the decision to go to Africa, we have a missionary coming next week, and Don Mann and his wife come and share. They are some of our heroes. People make the decision to follow God. And there's a lot of things that impact their lives and those around them because of that decision. When we were younger, decisions were made for us, for the most part, right? When you go to bed, when you get up, I remember, trying to, you know, push the 8 o'clock to 8:30, trying to influence my parents' decision. What you eat, when you eat, I remember even what you wear. My mom was great at sewing. My dad's a pastor. We didn't have a lot of money in the early years. And so, you remember when velour was the in thing? I was like, what's velour? Really soft and cuddly material that mothers could buy in bulk. My older sister, we had three boys, and all three of us had the same velour sweater. Now, I had the benefit of being the oldest. My poor brothers, they had to wear theirs. Then the hand-me-down that came from the second oldest. Then my hand-me-down eventually made it to my youngest brother. Poor guy, he wore that velour sweater way past. It was cool. They decide what we wear at times. They decide where we're going to be educated, what school we're going to go into, how we live, where we live, what house we will live in. I remember we were looking for houses. We had moved a couple times. We had pastored for 14 years where we were in Elora, and we made the mistake when we bought our first house. You know, you're just not thinking of kids and schools, and then all of a sudden you have a child, and you start thinking like, oh, yeah. So now, and if you parents, you know what I'm talking about. You have a child, then you start thinking, oh, when I buy a house now, my first thing I think about is not how close it is to the hockey arena, or how I'm thinking of what's the schools in this area that my kids will be going to, and I start checking out schools. Well, we had to move a couple of times, and I remember we were looking at houses, and the kids were younger, and we go in, and we were all as a family every time we checked it out, not just Pam and I. We'd go in, we look and check this one out, and we need some more room. We were kind of outgrowing the house we're in, so we'd leave that one, went to the next one, and what do you think, kids? And we were getting their feedback, and you know, they weren't really quite right there. I mean, you could tell, so, well, maybe they're having a hard time moving. It's not like we're moving churches, or but might move a school, and so they're a little hesitant until finally we got a little bit of feedback that all of a sudden the light bulb went off. We were in one, we went through the whole house and looked at all in every room, and we came back, and we asked them, what are you thinking? And I can't remember which child it was, but they were talking. I said, yeah, it's okay. Well, what do you think about this? And they said, well, really, your bed. We are. All of a sudden we realize. They thought we were like leaving our house and all our stuff and buying this house with all the stuff that's in it. So we were checking on these houses of these empty nesters, you know, and there's like no toys in this house. Our kids left like, this isn't a good deal at all. This like, we got toys, rescue heroes, and stuff back there. This thing has got like, you know, just little statues and paintings. We want to keep our toys. So we're like, no, yeah, you can keep your toys. You can see how much it affects these poor little lives. They were thinking, every house we would check in. Now, we go to the one house that wouldn't meet our needs at all as a building, but had lots of toys. They're thinking, this is our house. We want this one. This one's awesome toys. You make these decisions. The kids move. I was praying with the pastor up north, and they had moved, felt God had called them, and praying for the children and trying to find a house. And it's a big thing. You make your decisions that affect not only your life, but affects the lives of people around you. Our parents know how to motivate us as well. However, the older we get, we start to make more decisions on our own. Every day, faced with a myriad of decisions. There are some days when I make so many decisions that when I go to a restaurant, I just feel like, can you just order for me? I often do that. It's disguised in, do you have any specials? I'll just take whatever's on special because I don't feel like making a decision right now. Recognize that making these choices matters. Time after time, if you make the same decision over and over again, you can actually create a habit. Making a decision, and when you make a decision, is very important. Robert Schuller, and I don't follow him a lot, but I love this illustration, the illustration of the dead tree. He remembers a time when he was younger, and he said he was going out, they needed firewood for the house, and his dad took him out to cut a tree down. As they started to cut down this dead tree, to his dismay, he was discovered that the tree was not dead, and he saw some new shoots and signs of life. The father of Robert Schuller said, I thought for sure it was dead. It had dropped all its leaves. You see, it was wintertime. The father turned to his son and said, Bob, don't forget this lesson. Never cut a tree down in wintertime. Never make a negative decision in the low time. Never make your important decisions when you're in your worst mood. That's a good one, isn't it? Divorce care, we do divorce care. That's one of the things to say. When you got a major thing and a disappointment happening in your life and you're going through a season of a winter season, don't chop down a tree in winter. There might be life, you just might be going through a dormant season. How and when you make your decisions matters so much. If you choose wisely, we often receive joy and self-respect. We choose unwisely and we can bring upon ourselves some sorrows. Choice is an awesome gift. And Nehemiah, upon his return, I mean, these were all people that were being and had become more obedient to God. But obviously, as soon as Nehemiah left, they were subject to the result of their own choices once again. It was time to call them back. Verse 1 and 2. The source. On that day, the book of Moses was read aloud in the hearing of the people, and there it was found written that no Ammonite or Moabite should ever be admitted into the assembly of God, because they had not met the Israelites with food and water, but had hired Balaam to call a curse down on them. The very basis of wise decisions comes from God. When you first look at this, and you're right, when I read that, if you kind of probably felt a little bit put off by that, you're kind of like, well, that feels a little bit like prejudice. This is not so much about ethnicity or prejudice against a nation as it was about God's word. The criteria of healthy choices come from accepting God's word and applying those words. They had gotten off track because they had accepted others into the assembly of God. And instead of them being a positive influence on those that were outside of God and did not want to follow God, the people who weren't following God were being a bad influence on them. It's not just the nationality, because we know Ruth was a Moabite and was incredibly blessed and found a kinsman redeemer in Boaz. So it's not just the nation, but these individuals had helped Israel to make choices contrary to the word of God. The only possible decision was get rid of them. It makes me ask the question, who or what is the source of your bad influence? Is it the internet? Is it some friends, some coworkers? Is it a place you go, something you watch? What or who is the source of your bad influence? The things that pull you in a direction that you know you shouldn't go. Psalms 1:1 says, "Oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers." If David had Facebook, I think he was trying to call people to unfriend them. You know, those situations and circumstances when you know that this place you go is a place that doesn't bring you towards obedience. Or when you hang around and when you spend too much time in this area or with this group of people, that it has a negative effect on you. Some of us maybe need to unfollow. Not frequent so much that place. Separate. Verse 3. People of God needed to distance themselves from bad influences. It was the only smart choice. Removal. Rather than influencing these people, the opposite had happened. We get into this a little bit later in verses 23 to 27. Here's the point. The people of God did not need help in walking away from God. They did not need help in becoming more selfish. We have a bent that way. They needed people around that would help them make a commitment for God. After all, forgetting God is what got them in this mess in the first place. And then in a great kind of amazing writing style, we kind of have a little picture of where things were at the end. And then Nehemiah jumps back and gives us a backstory starting in verse 4. Before this, a little kind of, you know, in the old days, they had a little like the camera, and you go back into the past. Before this, Eliashib, the priest, had been put in charge of the storerooms of the house of our God, and he was closely associated with a guy named Tobiah. And what we eventually learn is that Eliashib chose personal gratification, personal gain, over personal discipline. And it would cost not only him, but have a great cost for the people of God as well. For the sake of advantage, we know this guy Tobiah was an influential man, a rich man that used his money to bring about influence and persuasion. He's the guy that wrote those letters a long time ago, remember? And he was always attacking Nehemiah from the very beginning. And as soon as Nehemiah goes away for a few minutes, what's this Tobiah do? He tries to weasel his way in there. And Eliashib opened the door for him. Brought all kinds of trade and goods into Jerusalem, which was great in one way. Look, we're growing. We've got a businessman in there making business decisions. But they started compromising their relationship with God. The power and the influence of money. Okay, at the risk of sounding like a popular Canadian band, what if you had $1 million? And $1 million isn't what it used to be, not even when they sang that song. It's not the same amount now. So, when you think about it, if you got back to your car and there was $10 million in it, okay, maybe you just checked your next time online banking, the balance is $10 million. And you had an unlimited, you could withdraw as much as you want immediately. Think about what you would do immediately. What would be your first decisions if you had $10 million? There you go. You got anything else? Think about it. I want you to turn to the person beside you and you tell them one of the first things you do. First thing I do if I made $10 million, I would, and could turn to the person beside you and tell them. Take a second, tell them. No, husbands and wife are going, oh man, I'd buy you something, honey. That's a good one. Probably somebody said, I'd pay off my Visa bill. I'd scrap my junker. I'd go get a new car, pay off bills, pay off mortgage, invest it. Maybe some of you prudent people would say, I'd invest it, live off the interest. Somebody said that. I know they did. And I know you're probably getting it, and I am. I'm going to give you the point. Would you say I'm going to give $1 million to God? I mean, that will be remembering. I mean, you could say, well, how do I know God gave it to me? You'd want to maybe find out who gave it to you to thank them. How much would we think of ourselves? The Bible gives a very sobering lesson. It talks about how you handle the natural things in this world and what you do with them. It has a great deal to depend on how much God can trust you with the supernatural things like the gifts of the Spirit. Because if you use the things of this world that are in your possession for your own gain, then if he gives you things for ministry and tools for ministry, you will use them for your own gain as well. We've seen that. That's not just a pew thing. That's a pulpit thing. I mean, someone can take the word of God, and if they are like Pilate, they'll take a basin of water and a towel and think of themselves. And so if they got a word of God, they'll take the word of God and figure out a way how to twist it to get their own gain. I've known people that will quote scriptures from here, and it has nothing to do with pointing to God. It just, they're quoting those scriptures to justify a decision they want to make or justify a benefit or advantage they have on someone else. It's no different. Whether you pick up a guitar or whether you pick up the drums and you put yourself in a place to think of yourself. I mean, if the things in this world, if you use them for yourself, Pilate, the night before Jesus was betrayed, Jesus took a basin of water and a towel and thought of others. So moments later in the Passion story, we have Jesus standing in front of Pilate, and Pilate, the authority, release him. And what's Pilate do? He takes a basin of water and a towel, washes his hands, and says, the blood of this man's on you guys, not on me. When we take what we have and think only of ourselves, we're not following God. We're not being Christians. We're being Pilatans. Christ took what he had and put others first. One of his first thoughts, it was his immediate thought. Okay, so does the Bible say money is the root of all evil? No, it doesn't. Pastor Tim was being instructed by Paul back in 1 Timothy 6. And he was warning the rich in the church. Okay, so not actually just warning the rich, but also warning the people who were struggling and striving to make it rich. Those are the ones he was speaking to as well. I know there's a big difference. I mean, those people I often find who are wealthy, they don't need to convince me that they're wealthy. They are, whether I believe it or not. It's usually the ones that are trying to be rich that try to convince me they're rich. Those are the ones that are usually probably who Paul's talking to when he talks to Timothy. Listen to what he says. We brought nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out. He goes on to say, people who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. Before I continue, I have been involved in situations in trying to come alongside couples and individuals, for instance, in gambling. And you would look at it, you'd scratch your head and say, why? When an individual would take some money and they're just trying to get ahead, and the root cause is some of it is actually good. They're wanting to provide for the family, they're caring, they're trying to provide for the future, and they take some of the money, it might be even a mortgage payment, or it's some of the money, a little bit of a nest egg they've been holding off for the kids' education, but it's not enough to pay for the whole education, so they take it and they gamble with it, and they put the money in there and they gamble. And then once they gamble, they lose. Now they're behind. Now they're behind even more. And in the desperation, what do? Now that they're behind even more, they take whatever they can scratch around and find again. And now they really need to get ahead. And so in the foolishness and in the trap of trying to gain, they throw at it again. They lose again. Until eventually, they're just not able to scrounge around anything else to throw into the pit. those who want to get rich fall into a temptation and a trap, into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Now, I'm not preaching against money. I honestly believe God doesn't give two hoots of whether you're rich or not rich. But if you love money, you will have a hard time serving God. If you hold on to it, if you hoard it. That's why oftentimes God will tap you on the shoulder and ask you to give away something that you value. What do you love? I know. Rich. I know poor people. I also know that money can destroy a poor person just as much as it can destroy a rich person. People of God had fallen into a trap. They brought in for personal gain the leader, probably getting some kickbacks or some favors from this influential businessman, and he caved. Gold is his god and greed is his creed. The Bible has about 500 verses that it speaks about money and possessions and greed. It's important because we're to serve no other gods. Slipping away, we see in verse 5, the results spread. It wasn't just Eliashib, but it was actually now into all the people of God as well. As they continued to make bad choices, their hearts became harder and harder towards what was right. He had provided him with a large room formerly used to store the grain offerings and incense and temple articles, all the things that were the proceeds and the resources for ministry. He gave him that as his living quarters. And also the tithes of the new grain, the new wine, the olive oil prescribed for the Levites, musicians and gatekeepers, as well as the contributions for all the priests. He lived inside the vault. Gradually, as they continue to make their choices, they become more and more ignorant and ignore what was right. To the point where this guy from outside of the people of God was gained access into the area where people, when they gave to God, he was the one that lived there. It still happens today. People choose incorrectly and gradually become more and more callous, and the reduction of guilt becomes greater, and pretty soon you can find yourself going completely in a direction that's not right. And you wonder, how do I get this far? And you get there the same way you eat an elephant, one bite at a time. A little bit more, and then the guilt of that wears off. A little bit more, you feel bad, but the guilt of that wears off, and you make just a bad decision after another one, and you begin to be able to more effectively justify and reason out your bad choices. It's not as bad as what that was. Gradually, that slippery slope. It got so bad that people had stopped putting a priority on ministry and the presence of God, and the temple of God and the word of God. And so with neglecting that, then what happened is the Levites and those who would lead in singing and all the people that were put into place by Nehemiah when things were being rebuilt back up, and the people that would lead in singing, when you come into the people in the presence of God, there was people that were greeting you with praise. They couldn't afford to keep them on. And so what had eventually happened, as we see, is those individuals had to be let go, and they went back to fending for themselves and hoeing rows and trying to make some grain to be able to survive. It's not just so much that they had to earn a living. It's the fact that what happened then was a neglect for the house of God and the things of God and hearing the word of God. Ministry and serving God was pushed off to the side. And the people that all rejoiced and celebrated that the walls were finished in chapter 12, and the same people that in Nehemiah 10:39 had said, "We will not neglect the house of the Lord." It's only a couple chapters later, and the house of the Lord was completely neglected. Didn't take very long. Neglecting the house of the Lord has consequences. Their unwise choices for their taste for prosperity. They struggle just to stay afloat. They're so busy then that eventually to survive and get ahead that they didn't do any serving. I'm going to speak here, and it's pretty pointed, but I feel like it's necessary. When we're too busy for God, and that's not just to come to church, that means anything. When you feel like the word God just kind of tapped on your shoulder and said, go help that person or go give that person a call. It happened to me in service this morning. I don't know if you saw, I slipped out. My phone was back in the media booth, and I had someone on my mind as I was worshiping. I couldn't get them off my mind. And then I looked down to be able to, sometimes I'll do this. And listen, by the way, far as permission, you have absolute permission to pick up your phone and text someone if God's put them on your heart. You can text in church. You're doing church stuff. You're telling someone you're praying for them. Telling somebody, you know, you care, God's put them on your heart. Absolutely, you do that. I was sitting there, and I thought, I got them on my mind. I thought, well, I looked down, and I thought, well, I don't have my phone here. I kept worshiping, and it got so that I couldn't even sing the words anymore. I don't know why. I don't even know why the person's on my mind, but out of the blue, I mean, I don't, just bang in my head. I walked back, got my phone, sent the text, came back, and I mean, and literally my text, usually I just tip my hand. I just say, I don't know why I'm worshiping, and all of a sudden you came to my mind. I just want to let you know I'm thinking of you and actually was praying for you, and then just knew that I had to tell you I was thinking about you in the middle of worship. And away you go. Because if I'm so busy doing this or pastoring, or if I really don't want to disturb things by leaving the front, everyone's going to think, oh, what's Pastor Jamie doing? Is he going to turn the sound down, or what's the problem? And I'm worried about all what everyone's going to think rather than actually just doing what God's to me, then all that's too big of a problem. Because there's nothing more important than just being obedient to the Spirit of God. That goes for just in the middle of worship service, or if you're at work and you got to give someone a call, or you're running an errand and you want to pick something up and bring it and deliver it to somebody, but it's out of your way. Whatever it is, if it causes, and if it's an inconvenience for being obedient to God, it's too big of a problem. You need to drop it. There's nothing more important. You're too busy for God, then you're too busy. If you are so financially committed that you cannot be generous and you cannot give, then you are spread too thin. Making a buck had become more important for these people than giving to God and serving Him. Okay, so it was time for correction. Boy, when I started reading this one, I ever hear my father. Verses 6 to 9. You remember that old show, wait till your father gets home. How many have heard the phrase, wait till your father gets home? Right? But while all this was going on, for the record, Nehemiah says, I was not in Jerusalem, verse 6. For in the 32nd year of Artaxerxes, king of Babylon, I had returned to the king. Sometime later, I asked his permission and came back to Jerusalem. Here I learned about the evil thing Eliashib had done in providing Tobiah a room in the courts of the house of God. I was greatly displeased. Well, he sounds very diplomatic. I'm greatly displeased with you. And threw all of Tobiah's household goods out of the room. I gave orders to purify the rooms, and then I put back into them the equipment of the house of God with the grain offerings and the incense. Nehemiah returned back to the city, saw the way things were, and as soon as possible made things right. You may have made some bad decisions in the past. You may have gone down some bad roads. But you know what? What do you do? I'll tell you what you do right now. Not tomorrow, not next week. Right now, you make it right. Right now. Right now, you kick it out, you throw it out, you burn it, you trash it, you crush it, right now. It's right now that you do it. That's when you do it. It's not like, well, let me think about it, let me get more. No, you know it's wrong. It's a bad influence. Chuck it. That's the only way. Don't, well, you know it's valuable. You get rid of it. You throw it out. That is the only other way. The only way is to separate yourself from that bad decision. Bad decisions don't just become good decisions if you just wait. How'd they get off track? Nehemiah was away. And he knew that if they didn't get back on track, the farther they got off track would bring upon itself greater consequences. problem, you're going in the wrong direction, it is time now for the U-turn. You find him going to the house of God, and I know what you thought of. I thought of the same thing. I mean, you're good Bible scholars. What'd you think of when he started chucking the stuff out of the room? Jesus tipping tables, right? Jesus comes into the temple and he sees all the money changers just trying to gain money. What'd Jesus do? Same thing Nehemiah did. He says, get out of here, you guys. Get out. Just starts, you know, chasing them out like an alley cat that's made its way into your house. Get out of here. Moving the thing along. I know, Pat, you wouldn't chase an alley cat out of your house. I know. You would bring the thing right in, and it's good. That's a redemptive quality, you know. But we have, you know, someone that sneaks its way in, and he doesn't take any time. It's the same way as Jesus felt when he walked into the temple, a place that's supposed to be a house of prayer, and these people had turned it into a place to make money. You know, holy indignation. This is not right. And I'm going to at least get rid of the wrong. It's time to change poor choices. It's interesting what he does. He does three things really quickly. Number one, clears the garbage out. First thing, get rid of it. Second thing, what's he do? If you work in the healthcare industry, you know how important this is. He cleanses the house. Wipe it up. This thing's dirty. Cleans it all out. It's not important to just get rid of the stuff and then clean the room. But then he needed to restore and replace what had been moved out. Put it back the way it should be. In our lives, it's one thing. You can get rid of this stuff or the bad influences. You can say, I'm no longer going to do that. Or, I'm no longer going to watch that. I'm no longer going to read that. And that's great. And you can purify and God can cleanse your heart and your mind. But then you also need to fill it with the things that are right and the things that are good. You need to read the Word of God. You need to listen to some of the podcasts and the messages. You need to fill your, you can get rid of that CD or DVD or LP. The LP, what's that? Well, you know, you guys know what it is. You know what it is. Get rid of some of that stuff. But it's not just that. You can cleanse, but then start filling with some of the good stuff that'd be able to lead you in the way that's right. These are hard choices. The secret to success. Remember, we were looking back into our vision stuff, and we're just preparing now our vision series, looking forward to it in the fall. We looked at past what was the right direction. Not really how we did stuff, but what was the right direction. What were the things that were the priority, that were the right priorities? Now we're in the difficult task of creating some action steps with this vision. Why? Because it's not important to just know that it's wrong or be remorseful that we went the wrong way. But you have to act on that wrong way and act on the right way. Desire changes very little. Spreading. Let me try to move on this quicker here. Verse 10 to 11. The choices we make in life are critical to both us and those around us. He goes on and he says, basically, the first thing he came on to, he saw all this and he kicked him out right away. I'm not going to wait. I don't wait for a council meeting. I'm not trying to. This is wrong and I'm making it right now. And then he kind of says, well, after that's over, I started looking around and I learned, he said, that the portions assigned to the Levites, those that led in the worship and led people in the things of God, had not been given to them. And that all the Levites and the musicians responsible for the service had gone back to their own fields. So I rebuked the officials and asked them, why is the house of God neglected? And I called them together and stationed them at their posts. There had become a lack of fiscal responsibility and ethics. They stopped providing for the means of those people that were leading in the spiritual health of the people of God. They started to funnel resources away from kingdom purpose. There's a couple things here. One is obviously the focus away from things that are spiritual. The other, I believe, in a practical way, and it's very important in ministry, it's one of the most important things that I believe that God has put on my heart in making sure that I walk when I walk in ministry, and that is to have fiscal and financial ethics and accountability. It is very, very, very important. Those on staff know, and great seriousness, because I believe too many times the people of God have been distracted and hurt, and their effectiveness siphoned because of a lack of stewardship and a lack of accountability with finances. The people who should have been paid weren't paid. And that's not right. I know it's just a practical, it seemed very small, but I believe it's just not as right as turning their back on the things that were spiritual. It shows you how far they've gone. Poor choices of the leaders that Nehemiah had left in the town created a domino effect. And because the problem started at the top, he was going to deal with things at the top. Resulted in no word from God, and the things of God pushed to the back. Irony is this: the choices we make in life are critical, but they're not just critical for us. We know all too well it has an effect on those around us as well. We're leading. Securing, verses 12 and 14, people began to return back to making the right choices. Just because a one man came back and started to set things back on track, it started turning the bus. All of Judah, verse 12, brought the tithes of grain, the new wine, the olive oil into the storerooms. They all started bringing back again and giving again and putting ministry in the kingdom of God as a priority. I put Shelemiah, the priest, Zadok, the scribe, Levite named Pedaiah, in charge of our storerooms, and made Hanan, son of Zachar, son of Mattaniah, their assistant, because they were considered trustworthy. They were made responsible for distributing the supplies to their fellow Levites. I love this text. It says, you know what? We need to get things going in the right direction, so I need to find some trustworthy. That guy wasn't trustworthy. Get rid of the guys and the person and the things that are corrupt and bad influence, and put into place some good influencers. Just one man made a huge difference. Soon the people were starting to put God as their priority, make God their priority when they're giving as well. They allow changes for Levites to then minister. And securing a way that is right, he names four appointed men. I love this. He's like, almost, he doesn't say that he made a mistake, but I wonder if he had some regret. You know, he gets everything all done and everything the way it's supposed to go, and he goes off on holidays or whatever. He goes back to serving the king, back to his job, being a cupbearer for the king. And then as he gets there, it all goes to pot. And he realizes, I made a mistake. I didn't think of succession planning. I didn't think of putting people into place to make sure we don't lose ground. So he heads back, deal with the problems, and this time he says, I'm not going to make the same mistake twice. This time I know I might be leaving, and there might be a day when I'm not here. And when I'm not here, I need other people here making sure this thing's running right. So he finds four trustworthy men and says, you're in charge of this, you're in charge of that, you're in charge of this, and you're in charge of this. And why? Because you're trustworthy, and I know you'll do the right thing. You'll make the right choice. And one of the best choices you can make is put people in your life around you that make good choices and release them to make good choices. One of the great things I get to do is pastor the staff. We got great staff, and I hire trustworthy people that have good character and care to serve and love God, and then allow them and release them to make good choices. Encourage them and praise them when they do. And I expect them to also hold me accountable when I don't make good choices, and so I need to have the same kind of relationship with them too. Make a bad choice, we need to have that conversation. He wanted to make sure that even if I go away, like I was away for this past week, preaching a camp up north, I'm not concerned one bit about whether or not the church is in a good place or has gotten off track in a week. Because there's good people in place to be able to make sure it stays on track, people that make good decisions and godly decisions. It's interesting here, he says something quickly. Man, I do have to move. Sorry, I got to move here. Verse 14, he says, remember me, O God. And it sounds like a little bit of a spiritual pride comment. I don't believe so. As he's just talked about getting rid of and getting things back on track, I think it's almost as if his way, as he's come back with a few goals in his life, he's a very structured man and a visionary. He says, basically, goal number one, God reporting back, restored, check. remember this. We did it. Now a Sabbath, verses 15 to 22. I'll speed with this one a little bit quicker. Making the right choices in life is much easier when you know that it's God's approval you should seek and not people's. If you can deal with this one, to make the decision that I'm going to please God and not people, it helps you with a whole bunch of other choices you got to make. If you struggle with this one, you're going to have a hard time with all the other decisions. The people during his absence neglected the weekly worship. Nehemiah takes a firm hand on this one. Here's what happens. Some of the influence were coming in and getting in and working under the skin and bringing things the wrong direction. And especially as they were trying to push things away from God, even on the Sabbath. And so as a way to push back, here's what Nehemiah did. He locked the gates. He locked them out. So sometimes you need to throw some things out, and sometimes you need to lock some things out. And when he wanted to protect the people of God worshiping God on Sunday, on the Sabbath, not Sunday, probably Saturday, but you know, on the having the day to worship God, want to protect people, making God a priority in their life, he locked some things out. Some of you, you need to lock out the internet. You need to put on some blocks on your phones. You need to lock out some certain passwords and have some provisions there that prevent this stuff from getting in. He reminds the leaders that it's this kind of habit of neglecting God that got us where we are in the first place. At first, these individuals that were traitors that were coming in, and they were coming in on the God's day and leading people astray, when they got to the locked gate, you know what they said to themselves? We'll just kind of hang out here. He might not mean it. They'll probably change his mind. The people will probably not let him do it. They'll attack him. They'll put pressure on him, and eventually he'll open the doors. So they camp out outside the gate, waiting. It's not going to last. Bad. Verse 21, I love it. Nehemiah calls out to him, "If you stay there again, I myself will come down and lay hands on you." I love it. It's like, his dad has come home and things that were crazy, out of control, and he is taking control back. He sees these guys down there. He shouts out at them, "Don't make me come down there." That's literally what it is. That's like maybe a little bit modern translation, but that, "Don't make me come down there, because I will. And you do not want me coming down there." He says, "I don't want you. Let's not tell you what. You put out the enemy, the bad influencers. You even lock them out. And they will still try to hang around." So here, this might be for you. If you have an enemy you've put out, a bad influencer you've locked out, you gotta really follow through that it's good and gone. Not just hanging close by. Don't just throw it out the front door kind of. You know where to find it if you want to find it. You need to trash it. You need to get rid of it. True leader is committed to the cause. It doesn't let there be any distractions. Succession. The choice to ignore God had a devastating effect on the entire nation. My voice is feeling the effect of a week of shouting and yelling up at the camp, but the choice to ignore him had a great deal of a problem. Nehemiah was walking through the town. You see the gradual kind of calming and the spreading of his observation. First thing he sees is that problem with Tobiah, and he deals with bang. And then he said, "Then I learned something else," and he dealt with that. And then as he was walking through town, even a little more passive, he became aware that there was some challenges. Again, Pastor Call preached about this, about groups of individuals that married other people of other faith, and the new generation kids were speaking in languages that were not the language of the people of God. Now, I know, first you look at that and think, well, that's a little weird. Why are you getting bent over shape over this? Here's the concern that came across Nehemiah. If these are God's people, why aren't they speaking our language? And it began to ring a warning sign for him. If they're influenced enough to start speaking languages that are not language of God or language of God's people, important lesson here for you and I. Dad and mom, what language are you speaking at home? I'm not talking about French or English or Swahili. I'm talking about what language, what habits, what choices are you making, and what language will your children speak? Because our children will learn from our language, and their choices will be influenced by our choices. This is a humbling reality of this text. Many times our children will find their impact on their lives in things that we had no idea were influencing them. But if we take the Word of God lightly, we will lead them to make choices that will take the Word of God lightly. If we live our lives to serve others and to serve Him, they will grow up with a desire to serve Him. Now, I know eventually they'll grow up and make their own choices, and that is a gift that you will give them and that God gives us as a great Heavenly Father. I'm not saying they have to. They'll grow up to make their own decisions. But the decisions you make today will influence some decisions they make in the future. If you make worship a priority in your life, if you speak evil of others or of the children, they will speak evil. We ignore giving of ourselves. We ignore giving to the kingdom of God. If we put God on the back burner like the people of God in Nehemiah, then we will influence our children to put God on the back burner. The language we speak at home will be the language our children pick up. Just on a side note, in the vision, you will see as we move forward. In the past, we felt like one of the things in our right direction is we put a focus on future generations. It was a priority for us. It always has been. Way back, future generations, not only inside the church, but in our community as well. And a huge part of our vision forward as a church will be next generation. And it should be. And if you would consider yourself to be, you know, an adult or someone who is a senior or have been around for a while or a veteran, you absolutely need to hear this verse of scripture and recognize that how I live my life, we must make the next generation. We must make that a focus for us. How well are we passing on, following after God? And make that our focus. Nehemiah doesn't beat around the bush. He takes action. And there's even one text there where he literally grabs the few of the men and puts the boots to them. Kicks them out. Takes him by the scruff of the neck, twists the rear, and throws him out of the house. Here's the summary, verse 30 and 31. Simple dynamic of choice. And this book is a book about a leader that was able to make good choices. And once again, he checks off another one. Remember me, God. I've invested in the future. So I purified the priests and the Levites of every foreign and assigned them duties, each to his own task. I made provisions for contributions of wood at designated times and for the first fruits. I got things back on track. I'm going to have the worship team come forward as we close. Big part of the call today is just if you are going in the wrong direction, you made some bad choices. Maybe God's put on your heart something that you need to make right. The application today, I think, would be pretty clear. I mean, you need to get all Nehemiah on that thing. I mean, you just go Nehemiah. Get rid of it, go home, chuck it. And I mean, not just put it in the trash can that's in the garage that you can pick it up on Wednesday. I mean, get rid of it, chuck it, destroy it, turn it off, unplug it, throw it out. You need to identify what and who has made its way in and start the process of throwing it out, locking it out, and chasing it away. so that you get back to the business of putting God at number one and at the center. Choose correctly, enjoy the fruit of God's blessing, putting Him on the throne of your life. Nehemiah's life can be summed up in three things in contrast to Caesar. Caesar said, I came, I saw, I conquered. And interesting enough, Nehemiah also came, also saw, and was victorious, but would be better off saying, I came, I saw, I cleansed, I established, and I provided for the future. In this summary, in these last couple of verses, it's almost like as his last statement, as he closes the book on this chapter, feeling like he had accomplished what God had asked him to do. The choices we make have consequences. Would you stand with me? I believe God's probably put something on your heart. We're going to sing the song. We've already sang it, King of My Heart. And it's just establishing what is on the throne in your life. God has said you should have no other gods before me. We make Him our Savior. We also make Him our Lord. That means that, yes, we have the power to write and the authority to choose. He gives us the gift of choice. But we make the choice to follow Him in all His ways. The most important decision you'll ever make. So if there's an area where you know is not honoring to Him and you've gotten off track and the Holy Spirit's tapped on your shoulder and turned up the heat of conviction during this message, whatever that thing is, I invite you today as we sing this, to figuratively at this moment say, God, I'm throwing that out. I commit to you that today I will lock that out and I will chase it away. And today I invite in your presence the oil of the Spirit pour in and chase away the dirty water of my past decisions. So make that decision today, and then I'm going to pray a prayer of action over your life that what you did make the commitment to do right now, that you will follow through with this week, putting Him on the throne. We're going to have Pastor Jordan lead us. Would you sing it and make this commitment to God? Establish Him.